Dean Penland. Hitting that sideline cut brilliantly. Dropping it right in, Gary Lappin! Off the post, there's a scramble, it's there! Wexford have found the glory days. Gary Lappin got the touch, and all of Croke Park has come alive.
Houlihan will take this. 45 metres out from his own goal. Huge one down towards Frankie Carroll. Runs onto Owen O'Neill, and there is another one!
Fáilte roimh a bhíne uisle, a fáilte roimh gachéine ag up for the final den bhliain nocha sé. That was the Artane Boys Band under Sean Brennan, a new band leader there with him. Give him the bowl of boss, start him off for the night. Which means, whatever it means, what it means is that this is All-Ireland time and we're here on the eve to celebrate two great teams that will be in contention tomorrow. Which is it going to be? Limerick?
Yay!
Thanks, son.
Yay!
All right. Tomorrow we'll tell all. We're live here on RTE tonight, but here's something new for us now. Coming live from both counties as well. Something to bring a bit of the atmosphere, the pre-All Ireland atmosphere, the excitement from Wexford and Limerick to us here in the studio. First, Limerick. Susan Brown, Susan Power is down there in Ballybrown, out Mungert Way in Limerick. What's the crack like, Susan?
It's great, Liam. It's absolutely great. But Liam, I have to say, there's precious few of us left here in Limerick tonight. They've all headed up to Dublin.
Are you happy with yourself there? I see you wearing a Limerick jersey.
Oh, yes, they're great. They're absolutely marvellous. Later on, we'll be talking to two of the stalwarts of the Limerick team in 73 who carried away the McCarthy Cup. That's Sean wonderful. Foley from Patrickswell and Liam O'Donoghue from Mungert. We'll also be talking to Tom Ryan's nearest and dearest, because this is him, his home club.
Oh, that's his home club, is it? Tom Ryan's, Ballybrown is his home club.
It is indeed. Oh, it is indeed.
All right. Thanks very much, Suzanne. Stay with us now. Stay with us now. We'll be back to you for more reaction. Now, here
Good
we are
now.
At the moment. We have with us on the panel tonight Jimmy Hartigan and Paddy Wickham, chairman of the County Wexford County Board, and Jimmy is secretary of the Limerick County Board. Fáil de Raibh an Seó. Jimmy, we also Limerick in due, we'll have Wexford in due course on this. What about this, Jimmy? 73, wasn't it, that you last won it?
That's right, Liam.
23 years. We say nothing about 2 years ago for the present. But what does it take to win an All-Ireland, Jimmy?
It takes a lot of commitment from the players and the panel and the backroom team. And I think our lads have put it in 96. They've commenced training in September last year. It's a full 12 months tonight. And I hope they will reap the rewards tomorrow by winning the All-Ireland final.
What about the costs? You got a cent about money?
The costs are extremely high, Liam, when it comes to training for a 12-month period with a 35 or 40-man panel. Mm-hmm. But in Limerick, we're very lucky. We have an excellent supporters club who do fundraising for us. Mm-hmm. I'd like to thank the supporters club and to thank the people of Limerick who supported their fundraising ventures. We also have Shaw's almost nationwide, mm-hmm. our sponsors, mm-hmm. and I'd like to thank them for their sponsorship.
It's no different for you, Paddy, I suppose, down there in Wexford. Who have you helping you?
In Wexford, mm. we are very lucky in having Wexford Creameries. Mm-hmm. Wexford Creameries are our sponsors for the last 6 years.
It's a hell of a costly business, though, isn't it? Now,
it's a very costly business.
Was there really?
Wexford Creamery and Pettit Supermarket, yeah. and the supporters club under Martin Quigley as our chairman of the supporters
Martin's
club.
Martin's chairman, is he?
Wexford Board wouldn't survive without him.
But all the same, I suppose the real cost here is the commitment of the players, isn't it?
Yes, just like Jimmy said, Wexford has started last September too. I think to win an All-Ireland today, you have to do that. As you know, Liam Griffin spent a few years down in Clare and played with Clare in both quads. And Liam was down there for the homecoming last year. That was Liam Dunnan and showed him for the goal game.
It's an extraordinary thing when you think about that. You mentioned Liam Dunn there. I think he was only a few months old when the cup last went down to Wexford.
Yeah, I'd say Liam was only a few months old. 1968. Yeah.
That's 28 years, roughly.
28 years ago.
What happened to you in the 70s, Paddy, for God's sake? You had great teams.
Well, we had great teams and we're very unlucky. There was times we drew with Kilkenny and unlucky coming out with a pint, and we used to come back every year in, year out, the same old story again.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you, we have a new story now.
Oh! How do you say that, Jimmy? Come on! What do you say to me, Jimmy? What happened 2 years ago isn't going to happen to you tomorrow. Jimmy?
Well, I suppose we thought after 65 minutes 2 years ago that the match was over.
Mm.
Hopefully we won't get caught tomorrow.
No.
We have to go the full 70 minutes.
Yeah, I remember it so well that day 2 years ago. And I mean, it must be some hell of a lesson for you, really.
Yeah, it was very disappointing, particularly from the players' point of view, having put in so much effort, and to be winning by 5 points with 65 minutes gone, and to lose afterwards by six. It was shattering at the time.
It was shattering.
But
you pulled out
tomorrow.
Of it. You've pulled out of it, and Tom Ryan's a great guy.
Tom is a great manager. He's there now. This is his third year. We've won 2 months of finals with him.
Yeah.
And lost the third one. We're back in the All-Ireland for the second time. Okay. And hopefully we'll do it tomorrow.
I don't know. I'd like to be like King Solomon now to know how to divide this baby in two so that both of you could win, but it can't happen. Anyway, thanks, Jimmy and Paddy, for now. Anyway. Dancing. Dancing at the Crossroads 96 is a song they're singing in Wexford right now. By the way,
there's a lovely little booklet called Clash of the Ash by Liam Gall and his wife Bridget, which has all the Wexford hurling songs in it. And this one coming up now, this Dancing at the Crossroads is in it. It's on sale around Wexford, and it's for the hospice home care down there. They'll be singing this song tomorrow, after tomorrow, they hope, down there. Anyway, it's a new kind of sort of Boys of Wexford, really, and here they are now, the Wild Swans, to sing it for us.
Beginning of September, we were standing at the station waiting for a train. There was Christian Christian Brothers, there was Nuns and Reverend Mothers, there was guys and drunks and others, and everyone was just the same. Well, there came a man of Scarfy from New Ross and Browns and Gory. There was buses from Bunclody, there was horses, cats and all. And as they stepped out on the platform, they were shouting and screaming. And as they carried Larry Murphy, he looked 25 feet tall. So what's the story, my story? Now what's this really bound for glory? And when the last of the cup was lifted, he said, we brought it back for you. And we were dancing at the crossroads, in the shadow of a bonfire, underneath the silver moonlight. We were singing until dawn. We were dancing at the crossroads, with the punching and the water, dancing cheeks and reeds and polkas, until the early morn. In every barrel on the main street, they were hanging from the rafters, and they sang the Boys of Wexford like it was going out of style. All the bingo halls were empty, and all the masses finished early. You know, I never saw the likes of since the time of JFK. And when we looked at John O'Gorman, and through the midfield he was storming, and then the Cusick stand erupted when he scored from 100 yards. And we were dancing at the crossroads, in the shadow of a bonfire, underneath the silver moonlight. We were singing until dawn. We were dancing at the crossroads, with the punching and the porter, dancing chicks and reason pockets, until the early morn. Yeah! George O'Connor, so many said he was a goner. But when he stood up in the Hogan, I even saw a grown man cry. When we were dancing at the crossroads, in the shadow of a bonfire, underneath the silver moonlight, we were singing until dawn. We were dancing at the crossroads, with the punching and the porter, dancing cheeks and rings and pockets, until the early morn. Here we go! Jamie at the Tin Reacher, Kershaw, Rod, Danny Lean, Tom, Cargo, Billy Bourne, Matt Story, John O'Connor, Tom Betsy, George O'Connor, Adrian and Fenlon, and Larry O'Connor, Rory McCarthy, Larry Murphy, Gary Laffin, Amos Gannon, Dave Grindy, Declan Moon, Jim Burt, Shane Kelly, Paul Finn, Tokyo, Adam Team, and the man that did the dream, his name was Liam Griffin, Seamus Cam, the Joker, and Jay Reckon, all the best, Freddie Van in 96 will be remembered with the best, Patrick Quigley, Wheeler, Jordan, Bucky, Murphy, Nolan Flood, and the names we can recall, Wexford heroes won it all!
Up Wexford!
Down Wexford! And Liam Griffin!
Thank you. They'll be dancing at the crossroads. They'll be dancing at the crossroads in Wexford tomorrow night if you do any trick tomorrow. Anyway, the local club now, and the families who played with them, the brothers and the sisters and the mums and the dads and all the uncles and aunts who support them. That's really the heart of the GAA, and we'd like to celebrate them here tonight. One of the great hurling families of Wexford in times past were the Quigleys of Ranure. Just have a look at this now.
Wind up on the ball wing, Ned Colford, up to Dan Quigley. Dan Quigley first time to Paul Lynch. Paul Lynch in the centre of the field almost collides with one of his own men, but then getting it up the field, coming back to cover up now is Mick Roach. Mick Roach being chased by Tony Doran, still being chased, but still Mick Roach. And Mick Roach for Tipperary, earning the applause of the crowd as he sends this one up the field. Dan Quigley, the big burly centre half-back. John Quigley up along the wing to Jimmy O'Brien. Jimmy O'Brien being chased out there by Len Gaynor. Jimmy O'Brien back to John Quigley. John Quigley making an angle for himself. A shot and it's saved by John O'Donoghue in the goal. Up to Paul Lynch. Paul Lynch adds to it in the air to Tony Doran. Tony trying to get it past Nolo Gom. He succeeds and it is a goal. Yes, it's a goal, it's a goal.
Getting it away, Martin Quigley, good run by Martin Quigley, Jim O'Donnell in pursuit. Nice ball by Martin Quigley to a nice dangerous one, in towards the goal, it's run on into the net, it's a goal!
Ah, there you are, we'll give him the ball of Boston for the Quigley brothers. Jan, you were... what were you, captain in 68, was it?
Yeah, that's right, Liam.
68. It's a hell of a business to be captain of an All-Ireland winning team like that.
That time, captain wasn't as, didn't seem to be as important as now.
Yeah. A lot of tension in it, though, Dan.
You were only a member of the team, the same as the rest of the boys.
Yeah. Well, the same as a lot of tension involved, is there?
Well, there's tension in any fella that gets into an All-Ireland, there's tension.
Yeah. How do you handle it beforehand?
Well, if you're not excited, I think you're in trouble.
There's a nervous must be up, is it?
If not, you're not tuned up for the game.
What about that, though, Dan? You then, 76, what happened in 76? You should have been on that team in 76. What happened, for God's sake?
I gave up playing in 71.
You did? There was some row happened, didn't it? Wouldn't happen now, Dan.
Well, I don't know, Liam.
We were talking, innocent kid, he went out to play hurling in New York, was that it?
Yeah, that's it.
And he didn't come back or something, it was a replay or something, that was it?
Yeah, there was a replay.
I'm dragging it out of him. Come on. Okay, that's and then there's John. That's
Martin.
You're Martin. You're the baby now.
I am indeed, yeah.
But you were on the minors in 68, weren't you?
That's correct, yeah. We won the minor All-Ireland in 68.
You won
the
minor and the senior.
Senior, yeah.
My God, that was a great record.
You're crest of a wave, really.
But you're now the Wexford Supporters Club, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm chairman of the Wexford Supporters Club.
And what does that consist of now? What goes on?
Basically, we help the county board in a financial way, both the training of the teams and also very much on the underage. We're focusing very much in on the underage.
Yeah.
We have sponsored or we have helped in the coaching of the schools. And we hope to help now in the secondary schools to strengthen hurling in secondary schools.
Yeah, but I suppose the schools are the basis of the whole thing, really, aren't they?
It is indeed. It's 68 was the last time we've won a minor All-Ireland, and we're very conscious of that. And I think to have good senior teams, you must have good underage teams.
You must, yeah. And of course, live broadcasting is helping a lot now.
It will. It'll promote the game, but at the end of the day, there's a lot of hard work to be done.
But I think it was you, Martin, who said to me or to somebody that, you know, the kids all want to be at Cantona nowadays.
I can leave, yeah.
Well, we had a survey recently in Wexford, and Cantona was by far the most famous, or he came out number one as the top sportsman in Wexford. And
well, big up, if you put the poll tomorrow night, it might be Martin Story.
Well, hopefully it will be Martin.
Is it going to be?
Yes!
All right, John is beside you. John, you were on the 68 team as well, were you, John?
I was a sub on the 68 team.
How many brothers were you?
There were five of us.
Were you all useful?
The three of us, and Pat played in the 65 final, and he played in the 70 final, and he was away for the 68 final.
But what is it doing? What is it there now, like in hurling families? Like, does it kind of run in the family or what?
Well, we came from an area with strong hurling tradition. We had the Racker brothers before us.
And sure, yeah.
We had the Codd brothers and the English brothers. There were very strong family connections in that area.
Okay.
And we all went to school in St. Peter's, which was strong.
I remember St. Peter's was a powerful team, right enough. Many a time we met them. We used to be in the North Monastery involved with them several times. Helen Carroll is down in Pierstown in Wexford. Am I right about this? Are you there with us, Helen?
I'm here.
Hi, Helen. How's it?
Good evening, Ireland.
Good evening, Ireland. Oh, Helen, we can hear you. Go on, love.
Good evening, Ireland. You're welcome to Wexford. I'm here in St. Martin's Club, just outside Wexford Town. And as you can probably hear, it's the noisiest place in Ireland tonight.
I can believe that.
And I just can't stop them singing.
Okay. Okay, Helen, we'll go with that, love. Give her the bowling boss there, Vino Oishler. Okay, Helen, run. We'll come back to you. We'll come back to Helen later on. Here she
stands. I arrived down in Wexford last night, and I have to say, it's the most colourful place I've ever seen in my life. There's purple and gold everywhere. If it stands still for longer than a second, they stick a flag on it. And even as a Kilkenny woman, they've managed to get me into the Wexford colour. I'll never live it down when I get home. It's almost 30 years since Wexford last took the McCarthy Cup home. Later on tonight, we'll be talking to some of those men who won the medals. But as it is, the model county is more than making up for last time. They celebrated when they won the All-Ireland semi-final. They celebrated when they won the Leinster final. And by God, they'll celebrate tomorrow night when Wexford brings the McCarthy Cup home.
Okay, love. Okay, Wheeler Wishlip. That's grand. Thanks, Helen. We'll be back to you later on. Now, there were other brothers, the Doran brothers, Colum and Tony, from the Buffers Alley Club. We start with clips from the 55-56, and then there's a bit later from 76 All-Ireland Finals. Have a look at these now.
Nicky Racker gets a ground pass, pulls hard, and the ball shakes the net. Billy Rackard is chased here. He swings the first time, he misses, he swings the second, and he gets it. Paddy Keogh pretends to go right, goes left, sends to Nicky Rackard, whose point brings the lead to Wexford. The jump for joy and the final whistle sounds with Wexford champions.
Rackard soon stretched Wexford's lead to 5 points when his brother Bobby was doing well in the Wexford rear yard. 2 minutes to go. Ryan passes it into Rackard. Up he goes, palms the ball, goes round his man, and there it is. The goal to settle the match.
Here he comes, John Quigley. Tremendous roar from the crowd as John drives it right into the square. Tony Darden, the goal! Well, you can't look more pleased than that, can you?
Okay, there you are, Vino Oishler. Give him the ball of Austria. Colum. Colum Doran. Colum, what were those years? 76, was it?
76 and 77.
Yeah, you were, what were you? You half-backs, were you?
I was a wing-back, yeah.
Wing-back
for 12 years.
That's right, yeah.
I was one of the ones, I think, that got into the round period with Kilkenny and Cork at their top.
That's right, yeah.
You played in... God, you
might
have five All-Irelands, lost all.
Played in five.
Well, between...
You see, that's the tragedy of it now. I really think that myself. There's a great hurlers like the Doran brothers now. You have one, Tony, of course.
I have, yeah.
Tony has one, but Colum has none.
No, played. I have another in club, all right, but...
I know that, I know that, you know.
Days.
Well, whatever, you can get one tomorrow.
Maybe. We hope so.
And there's Tony beside you. Tony the great. Well, we remember you so well, Tony. You have one from 68, of course, haven't you?
I have, Liam, yeah.
Yeah, you're full forward, weren't you?
Started centre half forward, moved full forward.
Yeah. Do you ever feel you should have won, Tony?
Well, I never thought we shouldn't have won anyhow, Liam.
I'm going to tell it, Adam, you know. Yeah. I met this fella down in the Talbot Hotel in Wexford one night, and it was the year, one of those 2 years now, and we say this, we won't say this twice, when Cork beat them. And I met this fella, I said to him, he was coming out with Sean McGeach, and I said to him, What would you think now, Tony, like, if I invited Ray Cummins to come over with the cup, like, you know? As he says, about the only chance we get to have a look at it. Well, that's the only... you were captain, weren't you?
I was captain in 76, 77.
Yeah. Buffer's Alley, wasn't it?
That's the place.
Buffer's Alley. What's the name from, Tony? Buffer's Alley.
Isn't I don't know. It's there for years and years. I don't really know what the origin of it is, but it stuck with us, and we'll hold on to it for another while.
You will, Tony. Was it a rough game? Rough game hurling?
Ah, no, not really.
No.
No.
You gave as good as you got anyway. You did.
Ah, no. I very nice. And wear them, Liam. He was all the tough fullbacks. You said just come at me.
I know. Yes, you were very innocent. I know that. You were a lovely, clean problem. Player, Tony Dorton was. No, he really was. Back down to Pearstown in Wexford. Who have you for us, Helen?
You're welcome back. You're welcome back to St Martin's Club.
Who have you for us, Helen?
2 minutes. 2 minutes.
Who have you for us, Helen?
Oh, sorry. You're welcome back to St Martin's Club. I have 4 men here, 4 Wexford hurlers, and between them they have 6 medals. I have Ned Wheeler, who won in 55, 56 and 60. Add a 4 onto that and you have his age. I have Willie Murphy, Vinnie Staples and Jack Berry, who all won in 1968. And finally over here, to keep me company, I have a Kilkenny man, Jim Mahoney, who's the club chairman. Ned, it's been a long wait since Wexford last brought the McCarthy Cup home. Will they do it tomorrow?
I think they will. I think we have the fittest team in the country at the present time. And in Liam Griffin, we have got a very shrewd and a very astute manager. Against Kilkenny, against Offaly in the Leinster final, that was a superb display of hurling. One of the finest, I suppose, seen for years.
And will they do it again on Sunday?
I think they'll do it next
That's
Sunday.
Great. Willie, it must bring back huge memories from 1968, or can you remember back that far?
Well, it wouldn't be great at remembering that far, but it do definitely bring back memories, because all you have to do is just drive up the road, drive over to Morrintown, drive into Bishop's Water, and it has to bring back memories. I mean,
was it this exciting the last time around?
I don't even know. The hype wasn't as much as it is now, because that time, like, we were in All-Ireland every 2 or 3 years. But at the moment, like, it's 29 years since we were in All-Ireland, like, you know.
Right. I have here beside me Vinnie Staples. Vinnie, it must be doing huge things for hurling in Wexford.
I think tremendous, Helen. You only have to look at sense the atmosphere here tonight, I think, to appreciate that this is happening in every parish in the county. And I think it's going to be, you know, we'll be expecting an under 21 title as well this year, and maybe next year a minor title.
So it's the start of something big.
I think it's a great boost for underage hurling in the county.
Jack, Wexford must be praying for a dry day tomorrow.
Of course they are, Helen, because a dry day is very important for Wexford, because Liam Griffin has changed hurling in Wexford to ground hurling and first-time hurling. And tomorrow, a dry day will be very important for Wexford.
That's great. Finally, Jim, I've heard you've been attributing Wexford's success to Kilkenny's hurling.
Oh, without a doubt. Without a doubt.
OK, that's great. Back to Dublin.
OK, Helen. Thank you very much. Well done. Give it a ball of boss. OK. Billy, up there is one of the great Rackard family brothers, the 5 of them, wasn't it, Billy? Billy Rackard, that's Billy Rackard. And there was Bobby, there was Nicky, of course. Okay. There was Nicky, Bobby, yourself, and Jim. Jim played in goals, didn't he?
That's right, yeah.
And?
John.
John, there was a fair, yeah. Oh, God, you said an awful thing about him. He did, you know. He said there was, I said to him, it was John, and he was 5 great brothers. Yes, Sir John, was he any use? And you know what Billy said? He said he couldn't hit a cow's ass with a banjo. Is that true or is it not, Billy? Okay, Billy, those were great years. 56 and 57, was it, Billy? What was it, Billy, the year years? 50?
Well, I started 50? In 1950.
50, yes.
The first game for Wexford in 49, and I finished in 64. Mm. So I played in 6 All-Irelands.
He's been 60.
It was 51, 54, 5, 6, 60, and I was captain in 62.
And you won the 56.
And 5 and 60.
My God, that's marvellous achievement. Yeah. Well done, one of the great Rackard brothers. What about that, Billy, before I leave you, Billy, it must be important to have the hurling. Although your dad had much interest in hurling.
Well, my earliest memories are going to cricket matches.
Yeah.
And looking out to the back of a Model T Ford.
For God's sake.
And you must remember, a lot of villages like Killan had cricket 11s then. He wasn't interested in Gaelic games. Yeah. And I saw him in the practice field a few times, and he was an incongruous figure standing beside the goalpost.
For God's sake.
And only once did I see him there. Mm-hmm. But of course, in later life, when his ego got the better of him when his sons became good at the game.
Thank God, he deserved it.
And
he
tried to become an authority, which was disastrous at times. He really hadn't a clue about it.
Somebody said to me once, you know, about Nicky, God rest him. Somebody said about Nicky one time, so, talking about cricket and talking about very la-di-daw kind of accents and so on, talking about cricket. And they said, how would that compare with hurling? Can you imagine, he said, Nicky Rackard on his way to the goal, stopping for tea? Martin Codd. Now, Martin, I remember Martin so well. Martin played for Wexford in that golden era of the mid-50s with the Rackard brothers there. And very touchingly, I think anyway, here's Cú Chulainn's son, one of those songs out of that lovely book, The Clash of the Ash, a song about the late, great Nicky Rackard, sung by his old teammate, Martin Codd, with his own son, Martin Jr., accompanying him. One of us.
The challenge of an ancient game brought glory, glory to your name. Though March winds blew, the crowd still came to watch you, gentle hero. Through life's long march you made us proud, and many a voice from out the crowd called out your name aloud, aloud, and echoes still resounding. And Blackstair's men who saw you then still speak of you in awe. On Cormans Green, where you have been, they tell of what they saw. We watched you on September fields, and lightning was the drive. You were the one, Cú Chulainn's son, in 1955. The hand that held the stick of ash, and the man who led with style and dash, old Carrick to Hull fell to crash, and Bennett's bridge and Turles. And when in later life you beat the devil on that lonely street, you taught us how to take defeat with dignity and courage. And Blackstair's men who saw you then still speak of you in awe. On Cormans Green, where you have been, they tell of what they saw. We watched you on September fields, and lightning was the drive. You were the one, Cú Chulainn's son, in 1955. The last parade was sad and slow, and the last oration spoken low. And as on green fields long ago, the diamond stood beside you. Old friends, they flanked you side by side, and the tears they shed were tears of pride. An ash tree toppled when you died, and scattered seeds at random. And Blackstair's men who saw you then still speak of you in awe. On Cormans Green, where you have been, they tell of what they saw. We watched you on September fields, and lightning was the drive. You were the one, Cú Chulainn's son, in 1955.
Lovely.
Day after day, season after season, your hair loses elements essential to its natural protection. New Timotei, now enriched with plant milk, reinforces your hair's natural protection, leaving it radiating health and beauty. New Timotei with plant milk. Natural protection for beautiful hair. House hunting this weekend, visit a Gold Shield development and see what you can save.
Have you checked out our new improved Aer Lingus winter flight breaks? We've huge savings on return tickets for two to Europe, the USA and Britain. Or if you prefer, you can use your winter flight break tokens to bring your family and friends home to Ireland. So get ready to book your seats with winter flight breaks only at Quinsworth Crazy Prices and Lifestyle.
A winter warning from Thompson's Waterproofing.
Got a flat roof? Let's face it, it's going to leak. So what are you going to do? Thompson's roof seal's easy to apply. It forms a waterproof barrier so rain can't get through. Leave it to chance. But the day your flat roof leaks, don't say I didn't warn you.
Thompson's roof seal, or Thompson's water seal for brick and concrete, from the complete range of Thompson's waterproofing products. Buy now, don't pay later.
Next, please.
Wago! Light and crunchy, and you'll see what a catchy feeling this can be. Wago!
The pleasure of a soft milk hazelnut cream captured in a crunchy wafer coated in delicious milk chocolate.
Light and crunchy, and you'll see what a catchy feeling this can be. Wago!
Kinder Bueno, the lighter, crunchier, tastier bar.
Bovaclox DC Extra, the new long-acting dry cow therapy from Norbrook, giving up to 70 days protection against mastitis. Bovaclox DC Extra from Norbrook.
Falta Ash, Arena Ushla, egg up for the final. Now, I just want to introduce two ladies here. The first of them is Sandra Marsh, and the second is Breda Flood. Both ladies with offices in the GAA in their respective county boards. Sandra, we'll take Sandra first there. You are the public relations officer with the Limerick County Board, is that right?
That's right, yes. I've been the public relations officer since January of 95.
Yes. A woman. Public relations officer.
Why are you so surprised, Liam?
Nevertheless, I am a shade surprised, let us say, you know. Rough game, this hurling and football, you know.
But times, they are changing, and women are coming to the fore in every field, and I'm delighted and honoured to be a member of the county board and to be representing Limerick.
Somebody said to me about Sandra that, you know, that everybody's day's work starts on a Monday morning, but hers starts on a Sunday. Is that right, Sandra?
That's right. There's a lot of work to be done, a lot of evening work with results and fixtures and that, and you're kept going almost every evening of the week, particularly when we're in the full swing of local championship and lots of games are being played.
Of course, you kind of grew up with hurling now, didn't you? Tom is your husband, is he? Tom Marsh?
That's right, yes.
That was, he was 70, what 70s was it?
Mid-70s, 76 he played.
And you used to have a cousin then, Mick Graham, was it?
That's right. Mick was unfortunate to lose out on an All-Ireland medal in 1973.
That's right, yeah.
He was injured in the league against Wexford the same year, and unfortunately he was without his medal today.
And that is Breda Flood. And that, your niece, how you not have Mick Morrissey?
That's great.
Great Mick,
yes,
I love him. He's a wonderful man. He's come over from New York every year to this programme.
Yes, he was a member. He had three All-Ireland medals with Wexford. He was wing-back on the 55 team, cornerback on the 56 team, and he came into the game as a sub in 1960.
Yes,
he was the
Mick, so
first, I think, and the only native-born Carlow man to win an All-Ireland medal.
But you're the hurling officer.
That's great.
With the Wexford Hurling, have a woman teaching hurling and being a hurling
But can officer? You give me one good reason why a woman should not be hurling officer?
Pitch in there, lads, pitch in there.
I've agreed. What
though? What does it mean? What does it entail? How many clubs have you there?
We have over 40 underage clubs. We have approximately 50 clubs in the county altogether. We have a number of clubs in Wexford that are dual hurling and football clubs. So there's a lot of activity. With regard to schools, we have over 100 primary schools and we have 15 second level schools. So I'm kept busy liaising with all of those with regard to promotion of hurling, with regard to supplying of hurleys and helmets for them. And I'm also a member of the Wexford Hurling Coaching Committee, of which Liam Griffin, among all his other jobs, is also chairman.
Yeah, of course, you're from Owlert, aren't you?
That's correct.
That's Martin's Club, isn't it?
Martin's Story, yes. And Liam
Donovan. Talk about PROs. Do you know there's a chap in this house, in this sortie, Kevin Hawk, and that his uncle, Mick Hawk, was the captain of the Limerick team that won the All-Ireland in 1918. Willie Hawk, Mick was his uncle, was it? That's Willie Hawk. There you are now. Yeah. There's something for you and you're in that background. Anyway,
and
all right,
I'll
girls.
I'll tell you a better one, Liam. Jim Mython from Owlert was a member of the Wexford 1910 team that beat Limerick in the All-Ireland, and he was a granduncle of the great Mick Jacob from Owlert.
Oh, Mick is here tonight. That's lovely. Wonderful. Okay, thanks, girls, very much. We had the boys. Now, we had the boys at Wexford in part one. Now it's going to be Limerick's turn. Here's a man with a James Bond name, really, Sean Connery, and with a Limerick anthem for 96, Limerick Evermore. Sean.
Limerick, you are always in my heart. Limerick, from the very, very start. You mean everything to me. Limerick are the team I love to see. Limerick, full of music and of song. Proudly the boys go marching on. Limerick, steeped in hurling history. This time it will be our victory. Rise again, Limerick, from the city and the glens. Limerick, now our pride you have restored. Limerick, we will cheer you evermore. Team I love to see. Limerick, full of music and of song. Proudly the boys go marching on. Limerick, steeped in hurling history. This time it will be our victory. Limerick,
the city and the glen. Limerick, now our pride you have restored. Limerick, we will cheer you evermore. Limerick, the best team forevermore.
The green and white of Limerick with, I hope I'm right about this, seven senior All-Irelands to their name. The last of them in 73. Here's now a clip from that.
But he still can't recover the ball. And it's back to Bernie Hartigan. And it's another point for Limerick. Coming out to it now is Richie Bennett. And Richie's shot is high and Richie's shot is good. His first score from play, his first score from play. McBrennan's got it. Oh, a lovely ball across into the corner. Pat Hartigan's got it. And Pat thundering his way out. The referee blows his whistle and awards a free out to Limerick for bringing Pat Hartigan down. You could almost feel the ground tremble.
John Jordan, Brian Carl along with them. That was well done by Leonard Enright.
Okay, there we are, Green Oyster. That's 70. All right, Pat. Pat, you were full back in 73.
I was the investigator.
Yeah, mighty full back you were. That was a terrible foul there on you. Who are those dreadful people?
Well, first of all, Liam, I would like to say that I'm delighted that you put Tony Dolan sitting beside me this evening because for 10 years he sat on top of me. So, so I think.
Never! Never, Pat.
So I'm delighted to have escaped this evening so far.
That's right. How many years? What were your years, Pat? What years?
I started in October of 68, Liam, and I finished up in June of 79. I had 11 years.
You were mostly in the full-back position, was it?
Full-back. I spent a period at centre-back in 73, Liam. But yeah. Most of my hauling was done at full-back.
Yeah, I remember that. You had an injury then, which was only happened while you were training, wasn't it?
Yes, we were training for the 79 Munster final against Cork.
Yeah.
And it happened to me on the Thursday evening prior to the game. Yeah. But I suppose, in fairness, you know, as part of all team games and sport in general, one has to accept that injuries are part and parcel.
But I mean, if you like, the sad bit about that was that it didn't happen in the course of a game at all. It was only a bit of training. You know?
Well, it often happens when your guard is down, when you're not as committed to it, you can walk into injuries quite simply.
Mick Jacob is up there in the audience somewhere tonight. And Mick had an injury during hurling, I think I'm right in saying, Tony, is it? Tony?
I think so, yeah.
It was during hurling, wasn't it? Mick used to be centre-back.
Centre-back.
That's right. There was mighty games between them. How about that, though, Pat? Like, some of the mammies might be inclined to ask, is it a dangerous game for the kids to play?
Well, as I said earlier, Liam, one has to accept that injuries are part of contact sport, and indeed all sports from that point of view. Mm. But, you know, one has to look at the games, and I think education is a very important part, with young lads in particular, because hurling is a very skillful game, and it's a pity to deprive young lads of an opportunity to play the game when you have an opportunity that you can give them headgear to protect themselves and to get out and enjoy the game as it should be so.
Why don't they wear them? Why don't they wear the headgear?
I think it's part of following, as I said earlier on, the education with the young lads. And if you start lads at 4, 6, 8 years of age wearing headgear, they will wear the headgear just as well as they'll wear their togs or their gear.
Bernie is beside your brother. What was it?
Midfield generally, Liam.
Yeah.
And, I played from 62 to 74.
So you got 73 anyway. We saw you there.
At the end of my days.
It was a mighty thing, wasn't it? It was a great day for you.
It was still being highlighted. I think too much down in Limerick. I think we should think the new crowd.
New crowd. Of course, you and Pat were also shot put and discus, wasn't it?
I was hammer and discus. Pat was the shot put.
That's right, yeah. And I believe I remember one year that you won the puck father.
That's right. Just one point about track and field athletics in the case of Bernie and I. One difference about winning a national title in athletics against winning a national All-Ireland title is that you wouldn't have 50,000 people to welcome you home.
Sure, I appreciate that very well, Pat. Yeah. Richie is beside you, Richie Venice. God, I remember one day with you in Turles against Tipperary, I think it was.
That's right.
The final point, was it, Richie?
Yes, final throw.
God, and it was marvellous.
Oh, yeah.
That put you into the All-Ireland, really.
It did, really, but there's only the other 14 had a big say in it. But as Bernie said, I'd like if there was something new to be remembered after next Sunday.
One thing about you, though, Richie, now there's no doubt about it, that you cannot win an All-Ireland without a great free-taker. Is that not so?
Well, that's very true, and lucky enough we have one at present.
You have.
But that said, we gave a little contribution to Wexford in 1960. We shared the square, Latimer Slim, played for Wexford, who was a cousin of Joe's, who's in goal at present. We won't be as generous next Sunday, huh?
Okay, Richie. And that's literally... Yes, Richie.
I have a brother home from South Africa to the match. He actually played against Cork in the 1970 league final, Peter. And he's gone back Monday morning. And I hadn't time to say goodbye to him yesterday. I came up yesterday. So, Peter, goodbye.
I love you, Richie. Well done, guys. Well done. Love it. Leonard Enright, you're in fullback also, aren't you? Fullback line.
From 1980
onward. Are you not some sort of relation of Richie's, like?
I'm his uncle. I'm married to his niece.
You're married to his niece, that's right. They're all married to each other. What years were those that you played, Leonard?
I started in 71.
And came forward then. Why didn't you play in 73?
I think they gave me a break.
Somebody wants to get looking at that, you know. I just elected you.
I suppose you would.
Anyway, it's great stuff. That's four of the great Limerick players there now, anyway. Okay, somebody else. Okay, Susan. Susan is down in Limerick. Come on, what have you got for us?
Oh, I tell you, I'm in fine company here tonight now. We've Sean Foley and Liam O'Donoghue, two of the stalwarts of that famous 73 victory, hopefully to be repeated tomorrow. And can I ask you first, Sean, how did you feel the eve of the match?
Well, quite obviously, fairly nervous, but around this time we were settled down, more than anxious to play the match, and anxious to get to bed early and get out in the morning and have a good walk and prepare for the day that was in it.
So do you reckon that's how the lads are feeling tonight?
Oh, there's no doubt about it, to be quite relaxed and looking forward to the game tomorrow.
Well, we wish them all the best. Liam, tell me, the spectre of 94 hangs over the team. How are they going to deal with it?
Well, I think that what they say really is that you have to lose one to win one. And I think definitely having lost in 94 will definitely stand to the Limerick team tomorrow. I think they're going out tomorrow and having lost the 94 one, I think they know what's ahead of them. And I think definitely they will win the match tomorrow as a result of losing in 94.
Well, please God. Now, and hopefully you can tell us as well the best moments of this nail-biting championship.
For myself, it was definitely the clear match in the Gaelic grounds in Limerick, you know, for... We were almost gone until that fantastic point from Kieran Carey. And I don't think it'll be as close tomorrow. I think we'll win by a number of points.
Well, we'll head over now and we'll meet the Ryan clan. Tom Ryan's family are assembled here before us. We have his mother, Peg, and his sister, Mary. Are you proud of your son?
I'm proud of him and I wish him the best of luck tomorrow in the boys.
And we also have Willie here. Willie's Tom's brother. Was he always so determined?
Oh, he was always very determined from a very young age, but it would be more appropriate, I'd say, for to ask some of the players that he played against himself to see how determined he was. They wouldn't belong telling you.
August Evely, Nia Tom Ryan, Curtha Capon to Urshan, Slim Rockamora.
Suzanne, Daring Gamayan Bua Kakalora, Glim Nakamora, Bayan Cleha on Dakar Fad, Daring Gamayan Score on Garda Kela, Akhtamig Sule, Tom August Kirani, Chak Duwalia, Erin Loon, Leshan Gorn McCarthick.
Ciart galore. And now here we have a man here who's married into very good stock. It's John Hayes, the Ballybrown chairman, and brother-in-law of Tom Ryan. You're obviously a popular man, John.
I wouldn't say that, Suzanne.
So tell me, how have the tickets gone?
Well, unfortunately, they haven't gone great. Most of our people here tonight, unfortunately, won't be able to be in Croke Park tomorrow. But that's it.
But you will be with them in spirit.
We'll be with them in spirit.
And now, listen, the First Lady of Limerick Hurling, Laurie Cross. You have written a song for the Limerick team, haven't you, Laurie?
Yes, I did.
Would you give us a few bars of it to play us back into the studio?
I could.
Yeah. Go on ahead.
Now Limerick fans will be cheering on the boys with all their might to bring back the McCarthy Cup to dear old Shannon's side. We have boys from our parish, just to name a few, Gary Kelby, Kieran Carey, and Barry Folito, and manager Tom from Valley Brown, and Jimmy the secretary too. They all deserve great credit for all they have to do.
Boulibus!
Remarkable phrase, of course, you know, God willing, or with God's help. You wonder what's the Almighty God going to do between two counties like Wexford and Limerick tomorrow? What way is that to be divided? Anyway, the dancers and musicians, I know this very well from my old Charmigas HM days, they've had plenty down there in Limerick. Now, the first time I saw this group now, they had about 30 musicians and as many dancers. We had to cut them down a bit to get them into this show here tonight. Huyn Uaisle, Os Liminach, Cuigi Faltariv, Planksty O'Rourke.
Thank you. Nestle, the world's leading food company, invites you to celebrate Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame, now showing at cinemas everywhere. A classic story that you can relive on the streets of Disneyland Paris with the spectacular Carnival of Fools. This autumn, be one of the first to join in the magic, because Nestle invites you to win one of 30 family trips for four. Fill your basket from the great Nestle range of groceries, chilled desserts, pasta, ice cream and confectionery, brand leaders and household names across the country. Pick up a leaflet and a family trip to Disneyland Paris could be yours. Join us as Nestle celebrates Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame.
It's back. And it's bigger than ever. It's the new winning streak from the National Lottery. With a new cash prize on the big wheel of £500,000.
Commemorating the centenary of Bruckner's death, Symphonies No. 2 and 8, played by the National Symphony Orchestra, conducted by George Tintner, on Friday the 13th and Friday the 20th of September. Enjoy these two concerts for the price of one. Book before September the 6th at the National Concert Hall, where RTE supports the arts.
My girl, where will you go? I'm going where the cold wind blows.
Mars. It's a taste, a unique sensation. It's the taste of life.
My girl, don't lie to me. Tell me where.
Sometimes it's difficult to tell a copy from the original. But we all have an instinct for what is real, what is natural. Like butter. Butter is 100% pure, 100% natural, with a delicious taste which is unmistakable. No wonder butter is often copied, but never equaled.
Walter Ash. Come on. Walter Ash. Walter Ash, I can show ar an éithe riamh an cluiche ceannais a mánaíochta. Now, with all this All-Ireland talk going on around you, you'd wonder to God, is there anything else going on in the world at all? Well, thankfully there is. Here's some of it. Lovely too. Francis Black singing When You Say Nothing At All. Now, look.
Can speak right to my heart. Without saying a word, you can light up the dark. Try as I may, I could never explain what I hear when you don't say a thing. Of your hand says you'll catch me whenever I fall. You say it better when you say nothing at all. All alone I can hear people talking about Webster could never define. What's being said between your heart and mine? The smile on your face lets me know that you need me. There's truth in your eyes saying you'll never leave me. The touch of your hand says you'll catch me whenever I fall. You say it better when you say nothing at all.
Francis. Lovely, lovely, lovely song, Francis. Lovely song there from Francis Black. Something to put a bit of civilization on us, you know. We have some people in the audience whom we'd like to especially welcome. The mayor of Limerick is Mayor Hanlon, is it?
O'Hanlon? Correct, O'Hanlon.
Ciarán O'Hanlon, is it?
Indeed, yes.
Ciarán O'Hanlon. 23 years ago, you're going to celebrate in a big way tomorrow night?
Well, I'm planning the mother of all celebrations for Monday night when we welcome home the Liam McCarthy Cup to Limerick, because Limerick is actually the sporting capital of Ireland. And we have every trophy on the sideboard, but we have a special place laid out for that trophy there, for the Liam McCarthy Cup. And I know we're going to do the business tomorrow. We have a great team. And in there.
Yeah, have you said your say?
Well, next year is a very special year in Limerick because we celebrate 800 years as a chartered city next year.
I know, yes.
And it's very important, you know, that we get off to a good start and we celebrate well. Mm. And we're going to do the business.
But Dominic Kirwan is the mayor of Wexford, isn't he? Dominic is the mayor of Wexford. And, of course, you're celebrating something in 2 years' time.
In 2 years' time, we're celebrating our Comoran Ocahucht. And this is one of the prophecies of Nostradamus. It'll be our third in a row. We start off tomorrow with the 96 All-Ireland, 97, and celebrate with the 98 one. Three.
I just want to say a word of welcome. Just a word of welcome to some people I see in the audience. Willie O'Dea is up from Limerick. Willie, how are you?
Hi,
glad to see you.
Great to be here, Liam. Looking forward to a victory tomorrow.
Rory, we'll celebrate tomorrow night. Is up there behind you somewhere? Rory is there. Father Willie Fitzmaurice, isn't it? Or is he Monsignor?
No.
Cannon.
I promoted you, Willie. I wind a nice white collar. And that fellow was a very dangerous hurler. What year was that, Willie?
A few years in the late 70s.
That's right. And over that side is, I think, Larkin Allen, who is he's the mayor of Wexford. Chairman of the County Council. And of course we have somebody else in the house who is Michael Sean Broderick. Agus tá sé sin chahir loch ar cuirle cúnta.
Cuirle cúnta limaní.
Limaní.
Agus beg rud éigin tám as manisir na féile.
Ó, sochtí.
And Abbey Fíl are in the county final, football final, at the end of the month, and that's something else that we'll be celebrating in a month's time.
Two celebrations, okay. Okay, if we do it, ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome the president of the GAA Oaktaran, Cumann Lough Glasscoil, Jack Boothman. Point row, Jack. Point row, Jack. You're right. Well, that's the end of your term, Jack, isn't it?
Coming up to it now? Not quite yet. I'll have to go to April, so I might leave American someday before I go.
Yeah, that's right. I'm not going to ask you to stick your neck out to say who's going to win tomorrow. You're too much of a diplomat for that. But, of course, the great achievement, Jack, of your time has undoubtedly been the wonderful stand. I mean, it's a wonderful achievement.
Yes, but it's not fair just to say it was achieved in my time. The immense planning went into that during Peter Quinn's time and John Dowling's time. So I'm just lucky at the end of my term to be accepting all the praise for it. But it is a tremendous achievement. Tremendous source of pride, I think.
What about the television
people.
Coverage, Jack? I mean, I have the impression that the live television coverage has improved the public receptivity for the game enormously.
Yes, I would say that. Well, we had a good product to work on. Hurling in particular this year has been very effective. It demonstrated all the skills of a passionate game, with none of the malice, which is very important, no malice in the game at all, injuries taken in the spirit, the good spirit. And
I mean, isn't that an extraordinary thing, though, Jack, and people? Like, do you think you could imagine that for 70 minutes you have titans playing with each other? And, like, rarely is there an ugly incident. And amongst the spectators, like, there's never a crossword, really.
Yeah, well, that's what amazes visitors to our country when they see the games. The fact that the spectators, first of all, walk down Clonliffe Road or wherever, side by side, have been shared in the jar in the pubs beforehand, get on the field and roar abusive at each other and at the players, and then walk off the field and walk back up Clonliffe Road and have another jar together.
Who's up there? I just want to say, Jack, who's up there in the audience? The McCarthy Cup is, of course, the All-Ireland trophy, is it not? And a hurling trophy. And that is Michael McCarthy, isn't it? Michael McCarthy there, and he's a great-grandson of Liam. Great-grandson?
Correct, yes.
Of Liam McCarthy.
Yeah.
He was London, wasn't he?
He was, yeah. He was born at Clapham.
Yeah. And how did he get involved in the GAA? Like all these, Michael Collins and the rest of them?
Well, he started playing hurling at the age of 14, I believe, on Clapham Common.
I got it.
And that's how he got his interest from it, I believe.
Yeah. And you have a cheque there in your pocket somewhere, have you?
I do, yeah. I was just looking for something else recently and just came across this by mistake. It's the cheque that he made out in payment for the
Turn it around to face that camera then. And it's the cheque for the payment for the McCarthy Cup.
Made out for £50.
My God, isn't that a lovely thing to have? There's a book coming out. John, would we say, John, isn't it, John?
John Meaney.
John Meaney, and you're doing a book on Liam McCarthy, aren't you?
Yes, Liam, the book's actually written. It should be out in about 10 days' time if the printers don't go on strike.
And it's
not being printed in Wexford or Limerick, by the way.
I know. How long did it take you to research that?
Well, it's the guts of 12 months, but it started really with me finding out that Liam McCarthy lay in an unmarked grave in Dulwich. That's how it all started. And then, you know, I chronicled the history and integrated the story of how I found the grave and how I went about putting the headstone on his grave. Mm-hmm. And it should be a very interesting story, and it's a story that every hurler should read.
Surely will. Thanks very much. Bless you. Any concerns tomorrow, Jack? Any great major concerns tomorrow?
No, I think the forecast for the weather is good, and the forecast for the game has been good. The two games, but don't forget the minor again, Tipperary and Galway, the forecast for them have been, the omens are good anyway. We have four passionate teams who play hurling, take their blows and go on about it, and I'm looking forward to it immensely.
What about it though, Jack? I mean, when you look at the contention between forwards and backs, it's a battle of titans, you know. Isn't it a wonder that there aren't more injuries rather than less?
Well, hurling is a skillful game, and you have to learn the art of hurling. Sure. Now, we try and persuade our young people to wear helmets, but helmets don't confer immunity on players or young players. They must learn the skills of defence as well. And this is why we have 15 master craftsmen tomorrow, some of them with helmets, some of them without helmets. Mm-hmm. But immaterial of that, they know how to defend themselves. Mm-hmm. And that's the important aspect of the game.
The other thing that strikes you when you see these millions of quid that soccer players have played all the time, and these boys are doing it for the love of a game.
Yes. If that ever changes, I think we will have lost the essential part of our association, the glory of playing for your club. These fellas didn't start playing for Wexford or for Limerick. They started for their club. A junior club, senior club, immaterial. They started under 12. They learned hurling from their mother's or their father's knee. This is the essence of our game. We have a game that's an art form, that every one of those fellas has a paintbrush in his hand instead of a hurley. Mm-hmm. That he's weaving a picture. He's weaving an interpretation of Irish life that far exceeds what you can do in a museum or in an interpretive centre. These people are artists in the name of the oldest game in the world. And that's why they're so successful.
Well done, Jack. When I see the names there tonight, Jack, you know, Pearcestown and Ballybrown, like, they're clubs. What's that great phrase in Matt the Thrasher, you know, where he says he's going out, he played his heart out, isn't that it?
For
the honour of the little village.
That's right.
Isn't that
and
it?
That still remains today.
Yeah.
While they're representing their counties, back at home, they're still in their own minds carrying the parish or the club flag. While they're anxious to be doing well for Wexford or Limerick, they still have, under the Limerick or the county jersey, they still have their club jersey. And they're going to die for that jersey tomorrow.
That's wonderful. There's no doubt about it. It's a wonderful game. I personally believe it's the best field game in the world.
I've no doubt about that. And it's the one game, well, in football as well, it's the one sport, one association, where nobody can hide on a field of play. In other games, fellas can take time out and they can coast for a while. But as soon as the fella starts to coast tomorrow, he'll be spotted, first of all, by the crowd, before Liam Griffith or Tom Ryan sees him at all. If he starts to coast, he's spotted by the crowd.
I don't know. I hope Tom and Liam are listening to this now, you know, that they'll be watching out for coasters. It's a new word we have in hurling.
There's not too many of them in hurling or football, but if they do rear their heads, they won't last too long.
All right. Jack Bootman, president of the GAA. Great to watch them. Okay, is Helen... Are you still with us, Helen, down there?
I am. Liam, I'm still here. I'm still alive. And we're all still singing, practically. Whatever happens tomorrow... Whatever happens tomorrow, it's going to be a very, very memorable year for Wexford. As somebody pointed out to me already, you'd have to be almost 38 years of age to have seen Wexford win their last title, and you'd have to be a fair bit older than that to have actually won a medal. And one man here standing beside me wants to send best wishes to two former players who can't be here with us tonight. Willie.
Yeah, I'd just like to send our best wishes to Shanks Whalen, who's in hospital at the minute in Wexford, and Pat Nolan, who's recovering after an operation. I'd just like to wish the two lads the very best of luck.
That's grand. Seamus and Pat, everyone's thoughts are with them. Finally, I have a very, very special woman here with me tonight. Mrs. O'Connor, the mother of two St. Martin's players, John and George O'Connor. You must be very proud of your two sons.
I am. Pardon me, I'm very proud of them.
Did you ever think you'd see the day where an All-Ireland medal might come home?
I'm always optimistic, and always was.
And will they win?
Of course.
Yeah. Finally, I'm sure everyone here would like to send their best wishes to the team, and what better way than with the boys of Wexford. So everyone together. Come on, everyone, the boys of Wexford. Well, I don't know the words, so you better start.
There we are. Thanks very much. And now Susan Brown in Ballybrown in... Susan, I just keep on mixing up these. Susan Power in Ballybrown in Limerick. How are they all feeling down there about tomorrow, Susan?
Oh, they're feeling wonderful. And I tell you what, we know we're going to win now because Father Brendan Murphy, the parish priest, has had a word with God, haven't he, Father?
Well, we said a few prayers then.
How many novenas have been said?
Well, we're praying all year anyway for them.
Yeah. I'm glad to hear that. And I tell you something, Helen Carroll said Wexford was the noisiest place in Ireland. I know an even noisier one. The band is going to play us out with Limerick, You're a Lady. And wait till you hear this.
Thanks very much, Suzanne Dunn and Ballybrown. I'd hope to get everybody in tonight. We missed out on a couple of them. Dave Burney is over there, one of the great Wexford hurlers. Several other people in the studio, we couldn't get them in. Anyway, that's pretty well it for now, Aoghaina Uaisle. All we can say about tomorrow, Jack, is may the best team win. Maybe one thing more. I've said it already. It's this now. Two teams tomorrow, in my view, are playing the best field game in the world. And more people around the world, I happen to know about this, I've been abroad a bit and looked at this. Thanks to television, I'm beginning to realise it. My thanks to Jimmy that was here earlier, and Paddy Wickham, to Jack Bootman, President, you especially, Jack, because of your presence here over the past few years. We all wish you well at the end of your term. Go Nairi on board lap, Jack Bootman. Shindere on Flores, Don Leach and Nocht, Aoghaina Uaisle, to take us out. What else but the Artain Boys Band on the One Road, Slán agus Beannacht.
Because I'm sure...